posse right here. Give it to him. Michael Wolf, Star, Peter, John V, Chuck in the back there. And it's a pleasure to have you all here tonight. You know who those people over there are in the dog pound? Those are people who all do Sammy Davis Jr. impressions. All those people have their own unique Sammy Davis Jr. impression. Oh, gosh. What's in the news today? The Supreme Court has ruled, and this is interesting, in most cases of dollar porn, that the services are protected by the Free Speech Act under the Constitution. And I'm real happy about that because I don't want to break the law. That's how I spend most of my spare time. There's a Hollywood rumor that Don Johnson and Melanie Griffith are secretly getting married this week. I don't know if that's true, just a rumor. In a related story, Philip Michael Thomas plans to marry himself in an elaborate ceremony. Yes. Now, this guy is explaining to the guy next to him. That's frightening.
He's the black guy. On Miami Vice, but just forget it. Go back to sleep. It's canceled, okay?
Yeah, Philip is the bride, the groom, and his own best man, which is kind of interesting. The company that owns SeaWorld is selling it. They've run into financial problems. They want to get rid of it. And apparently, Dom DeLuise is going to buy it because the price of SeaWorld is less than what he pays for the average seafood meal. So, thank you very much. You're too kind. Thank you very much. Oh, you're beautiful. They're screaming, you, you, you. That's, it's so wonderful. Oh, guys, have you seen this picture? Sandy, show them this picture that was in the paper. They have a device now so that men can see what it's like to be pregnant. Isn't that interesting, fellas? See, now you'll be more sympathetic, you know, and you'll understand what it's all about because you have that heavy thing. It's kind of like after a six-pack. I think we already know how it feels, you know? Let me see that photo one more time. The funniest thing about the photo is the guy wearing it, if he were a woman, nobody would sleep with him. He would never get pregnant. Look at him. That has to be the ugliest man in the paper today. That's kind of interesting, huh? Oh, boy, can you see a bunch of guys sitting around with those on trying to understand what their wives are going through? You know, let me touch yours, Bob.
You're carrying so well, man.
Lloyd Benson, senator from Texas, who was, I guess Lloyd ran with Dukakis, didn't he? Yeah. When he was running, he resigned from three country clubs because they didn't permit blacks to be a member of the country club. And yeah, he resigned because he wasn't going to have it, you know. And it's funny because this week he rejoined. I guess he said, if I can't live at the White House, I ain't hanging out with black people either. He got back in the clubs. That's amazing. I understand, Lloyd. Don't feel bad, you know. It was just too much pressure hanging out at integrated country clubs. He didn't want to be bothered with that. If he see black people at the country club, he want them working.
We're looking for you, Lloyd.
See, now Lloyd's going to be scared when he walked down the street. I wonder if that black guy saw the monologue there. They asked Dan Quayle if he had a comment, and he said, well, Senator Benson, you're no Martin Luther King now, are you? So he got him back. Definitely got him back. There's a new directory available now. This is interesting. New directory available that tells you whether your favorite stars have ever done a nude scene. You know, in movies and stuff. See, now you know exactly how far into the movie, what movies. You can actually look up the name and then figure it all out. And see, I think this is great. You don't have to watch Bodacious Tatas all the way through, you know? You know that 23 minutes in, the Oprah scene comes on, and you can just go right to it, you know? Jump right into it, you know? There she is, honey. Let's move on to frisky business now. The nude Oprah scene.
Yeah.
Oh, guys, they also give a lot of interesting information about probably movies you've seen and you didn't recognize people. Like, apparently in the Porky's 1, B. Arthur does a wet T-shirt contest, but you got to look real careful or else you you won't catch it. John, you're looking at me like you saw Porky's and you don't believe me. How you doing, man? All right? You all right, Mike?
Yeah, great.
Have a good weekend?
I went to New York, man. It was great.
Really?
Yeah, I went to New York.
What'd you do in New York?
I went to a friend's wedding and performed a little bit, hung out.
Really? See, you have to perform at weddings when you go?
Yeah, I did. I sat in. It was embarrassing.
See, I hate that. See, musicians, I guess, have to do that, too. I hate when you go to somebody's house. When you're a comedian, like, if you're a plumber, people don't say, excuse me, man, would you come fix this pipe for me while you're here? I'm at a wedding. No, just get the pipe real quick, you know? But musicians and comedians, they always want to perform, you know? So you're at somebody's wedding.
And you feel bad if you don't do it, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a friend.
You do. How's New York?
New York is beautiful. Beautiful weather.
Yeah. Takes a lot of adjusting. When you go to New York, there's a lot of adjusting because out here, everybody speaks, you know? Out here, everybody is like, hi, how are you? And they stand around and listen for responses. Oh, I'm pretty good. Got an ingrown toenail, but other than that, you know? You can't do that much talking in New York. In New York, it's like, you know, you might give somebody this, you know, just to let them know you are, you know? They don't talk much. They don't get into all that conversation, you know? If you ever go to New York, walk up to somebody and say, hi, how are you? And they say, you better get away from me, man. You some kind of freak, get away from me, man. Be talking to me. Oh, gosh, I'm glad you all came. We got a wonderful show for you. Comedian Ellen DeGeneres is here. We have clips from Bodacious Tatas here. Yeah. And of course, the author of Why Me, Sammy Davis Jr. is here. Yes. That's it. You all know what time it is now, right? What time is it? Well, where are you, Sandy? Right here? That's the book. It's called Why Me, and I've always wanted to bring somebody out by saying, this man needs no introduction. You can do it today, can't you? Sammy Davis Jr. Yeah!
They still scream for you.
Can I just say to the audience in the studio, thank you for the warm reception. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I'm coming back again.
They're nice people. Very nice people. I tasted your barbecue sauce.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, see, I expected it to be, you know how most black folks like, you know, barbecue sauce. That kind that it said, woo! You know? But your sauce is kind of a crossover sauce. It's nice. You can share it with your friends and everything. Because my uncle makes sauce and you can't get near it, you know? I mean, it's frightening. But your sauce is real good, real tasty.
To me, being a, you know, I started cooking about
14 years ago, mm-hmm. messing around with a fry pan and then fade out, fade back in. About $100,000 later, including a private kitchen. You've mm-hmm. been at the house, so you yeah. know it, the one that's down there. I go down there and I cook. And I started working with recipes and fooling around. But I found out something. If you get into the food business, and I hope you're not upset, Paul, if you get in... If you get into the food business, what you've got to do, I try to leave a little space so that if some, everybody don't like hot, you know, yeah. somebody's got to, you know, got to, my wife loves hot sauce. Altavis put hot sauce on cornflakes, man. I swear to you, put it on anything, rah, 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 rah. Yeah. And I've got a gentleman that's, I've been associated with, he's in the band. Yeah. He is my conductor, second in command. His name is Fip Ricard. He has them little bottles of hot sauce. Mm-hmm. So that he has them all over. So that yeah. whatever happens, if it's a french fry, beep, beep.
Yeah.
You know, beep, beep. That's it. You know, yeah. put the, but I, you can't do that with things that are going on the shelf, I don't think. Yeah. So I try to make it not neuter, but try to make it so that, hey, yeah, that's interesting. I think it needs some more hot sauce in it. Yeah. Then you can have it.
You got a lot of food products. You got mustard.
Yeah, mean and, mustard, it's called.
Mean mustard.
Mean mustard. Because yeah. I figured that the brothers would like that.
Yeah.
Because you know you ain't never going to see a brother going, I beg your pardon, could I try that gray poupon? That when we get around to doing a commercial, I want to be leaning in the back of the car like this and go, hey, man, give me some of that mean mustard. Yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Where can you buy the stuff at?
Well, it'll be on the market on the West Coast. We just opened up in, Detroit, which is Michigan, of course, mm-hmm. Cleveland, Ohio, and Pennsylvania. Ohio, Pennsylvania, and Michigan. And they're the test markets, and thank goodness it's going very well. It'll yeah. soon be out on the West Coast and all over.
That's good. How did you get into cooking, and why?
I got into cooking after I got off drugs. Mm-hmm. I had to find something to do with my hands, because I'd come up. And I'm serious, man, mm-hmm. you know. You're sitting there going like...
yeah. What else can I do with a straw? Let's see.
You know, and after I had all the spoons melted down, you know, it's... then you figure out... So I started, and because the partying days were over, man, mm-hmm. and I come off the stage, and I didn't know what to do with myself, and the first thing I found out was, if you change your lifestyle or you want to change it, you, unfortunately, a lot of people who are associated with you in this world, that lifestyle, you have to stop seeing because yeah. you can't stand the pressure. You mm-hmm. understand? Particularly in the beginning. Mm-hmm. So I had to stop seeing it. So there's no partying, no nothing. Go to your room, man, and sit there and feel sorry for yourself, which yeah. is what I did. Nobody, I have to get like this, nobody. Mm-hmm. Sure, on the stage, I'm good, nobody up here, blah, 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 you know. And I started cooking with one fry pan.
Yeah.
And did that for about a year and a half. Just would come upstairs and mince and dice, you know, and mm-hmm. then, well, I can only tell you that now I carry 5 foot lockers.
Yeah.
Worth of, you know, electric stoves and this, that, and the other. And when I get to Vegas, where I'm going, mm-hmm. tonight, God be on our side, we make it to Vegas, mm-hmm. I'll be right in the kitchen. By 11:30 tonight, be in the kitchen cooking.
How much?
Mincing and dicing. What are you doing, Sammy? I'm mincing and dicing.
So you talk about friends. How much of drug use was because it was a way of socializing and attracting friends?
It wasn't any of those things with really? Me, Arsenio. I did it because, first of all, I'm still waiting to get high. Mm-hmm. That's the God's honest truth. I'm still yeah. waiting to get high.
Just didn't happen for you.
It didn't happen for me. And now, booze. Ooh. Booze? I love booze. You understand me? And that's,
they're all, you abuse anything, but drugs was just something because it seemed to be everybody was doing it and I wanted to be within with everybody. Mm-hmm. But man, to really get a nice buzz, you know, give me a little bourbon, give me a little vodka. I miss booze. See, I don't miss the other stuff, mm-hmm. but I miss not drinking.
And why did you stop drinking?
Because the doctor said you're going to die. You will die if you keep on drinking. And my stomach swole out to here, you know, and ain't nothing worse than a guy that weighs 112 pounds with a big stomach out here. You know? People going, oh, you look healthy. You know? And there was all the liver just backed up on me.
Yeah.
So I was a very lucky man because I almost died. Wow. And which subsequently led me to become involved with the Liver Institute, which I now it's named after myself. And New Jersey, out in Newark, medicine, the College of Medicine and Dentistry, and it has a wing called the Sammy Davis Jr. Liver Institution, and I couldn't be prouder because, man, that's where it's at.
We'll take a commercial and come right back with Sammy Davis Jr.
Still are.
Thank God I can wear that same suit today.
That's amazing. You were bad then and still bad. And the reason I say that is because I saw you on HBO recently sing Michael Jackson's Bad. I was in shock. You know how you turn over because you think, maybe I'm dreaming this. And I look up and I see you.
Your butt is mine.
And you were working it.
First of all, I honestly, truly love Michael.
Mm-hmm.
He's really like a son to me. And he is so fantastic as a performer. And I love the moves he makes because had I really gotten further as a dancer, you know, because I started out as a hoofer,
mm-hmm.
but somewhere along the line, I got into instruments and doing impersonations and this, that, and the other, trying to be, you know, Wonder Boy.
Mm-hmm.
And so the dancing took second place with me. I think I may have been, I guess I was, the Michael Jackson of the 50s.
Yeah, absolutely.
For me,
yeah. Absolutely, yes. Yeah.
In the moves, you know.
Mm-hmm. You know, when I was reading through your book, I think the thing that I thought about that really kind of made me sad was, I guess I always thought that having the kind of talent that you have makes living in America a little easier.
Mm.
A little easier, at least. And see, because you did this at one time.
Yeah.
And everybody told me not to do it because a black man couldn't pull this off in
Absolutely.
America. It scares me when I read that they painted you white. They poured urine in your beer.
Yeah.
Things of that nature. I mean, did these things really happen?
Yes, they really happen. But in that day and time, it was more blatant than it is now, except in certain areas. Every once in a while, you'll pick up a paper and you'll read something today and you'll see it and it yells out at you, racism, you know, and you know it. And the way that the story is framed, it is there to stir racial emotions. In the 40s, in World War II, you know, they were still using terminology like stay in your place,
mm-hmm.
you know, and all of that, man. You belong over there. They had separate regiments. in even in the integrated unit that I eventually got into, nobody wanted to be there. The cat said, I was around the black, or in those days, the colored guys. We had a, I was in a kind of an odd situation because I'm going, hey, I don't know anything about this outside world. I belong to show business. Show business says, go for it and be, and yeah, and let's go, fellas. Yeah. Hey, I got a barn. Let's put the show on here. You know, all of those cliches I lived, you know, and the other guys are going, don't be doing that. Don't do that. You gonna get us in trouble, you know? And I couldn't understand it. And I didn't want to use the terminology that they used in those days, and they still use today, sometimes rightfully so. Hey, man, don't be a Tom, you know?
Yeah.
Go out there and do what you're supposed to do. And the white guys that were in the unit resented it. And the guy said to me, and I was to hear this said to me 25 years later, but by my own people. He wants to be white. Mm-hmm. I don't want to be white. Because if I was white, I think a white Sammy Davis Jr. would be bad. You understand what I'm saying? I think it's because of what I am, because of my innate blackness. My innate blackness. It's not yours. Mm-hmm. It ain't Richard Pryor's. It ain't Sidney's. Mm-hmm. It isn't Eddie Murphy's. But it's mine. Try to represent in your position. And you do it every day. And I'm not blowing smoke up your nose. No, I meant that in a nice way. I had to clean up quick, you know. You come out and you do your thing, and you'll do your, you do the humor that is now humor. And if you'll deal with a white situation or a black situation, you'll deal with the problems of today, you do it with humor. I tried to do it with entertaining, to try to get some doors open, because all of them were closed in those days. All of them were closed. You know, I can still remember back before you were born that they canceled a show. They were this close to canceling a Bell telephone hour, if I'm not mistaken. That was the sponsor. With Harry Belafonte and Julie Andrews. Mm-hmm. Because he went like this. Thank you, Julie, for coming. I don't mean an embrace or a kiss on the cheek. That was, I had to do that, you know, that kind of bad taste I had to do. But it wasn't done because there was a point of view in terms of, I'm going to go out to shock people. It was done because that's the way I am. I'm gregarious. When we saw each other this afternoon, I grabbed you, hugged you, because I wanted to let you know my affection for you. Mm-hmm. Now, I do that. And in those days, being overly theatrical, you know, with like the Rings or the Nehru or whatever the fad was in, so in the Army, I had it, but nobody else had that kind of feeling. And you weren't supposed to do it. So my being gregarious led to the guys, gave them all the food for fodder they needed to say, hey, man, get that nigga now. Stop him. Mm-hmm. And the more they said, get him, the more I used what the man upstairs gave me to fight him back. Because I figured, I'm too small. I tried physically. I got my nose broke 3 times, man, trying. No, that's it. It was broke. It didn't. It was never like this, you know. But it was a little better than it is now. But I couldn't. I couldn't deal with it, and it hurt. And nobody was there. They were there, but I'm saying, you couldn't do anything about it. You had nobody to back you up. Not the government. Not the people. Not the city. And if a guy did something, he had to do it on the sneak. I got so tired of sneaking around just to have dinner with someone that you thought was attractive, that you had something in common with, or you just thought was fun. No, you weren't allowed to do that. So I said, I'll show them I'm allowed to do it. And as soon as I got my foot in the door, I started doing everything that I ever wanted to do. Now, I went overboard with it. I went off the deep end. That's all.
We'll take a quick commercial, come back with Sammy Davis.
Before you go any further, mm-hmm. Ken, I know it wasn't planned. Mm-hmm. Can I do a number with the guys?
Yes. Okay. Wait a minute. Sammy. Wait a minute.
Okay. What do you want? I mean, can you all work it out? A certain.
Yeah, let me.
There's a mic.
You sound too good, man. I can't let you cats be over here. Hello, everyone.
Y'all work it out. They gotta figure it out.
Okay. One, two. One, two. This is truly ad-lib, ladies and gentlemen. Time after time, I tell myself that I'm so lucky to be loving you. So lucky to be the one you run to see. In the evening when the day is through, I only know what I know. The passing years will show. You've kept our love so young, so new, and time after you kept our love so young, so new, and time after time, you'll hear me say that I'm so lucky to be loving you. I'm so lucky to be
still on the air, right? We're still on the air, okay. Yes, Sammy Davis Jr. And my posse under the direction of Mr. Michael Wolf. Yes.
I must thank the lady and the gentleman for being so kind enough to go along with me on that.
Yes. Star.
Thank
Mike
you for the key keyboards. Too, man. If I don't know what key I sing, 60 years in show business, yeah. And I don't know what keys I sing in. That's the God's honest truth. If someone had a 38 upside my head, tell me the key that you sing that in. I don't know, shoot me.
Yes. You are presently on your way to Vegas to perform with who?
With Jerry Lewis.
That should be fun.
Yeah, we've done it a couple of times. Yeah.
You and Jerry are good friends.
We have been friends, I would say, 44 years. And the nice thing about being where I am now, Arsenio, here, is that I work with people mm-hmm. that I like to work with. Mm-hmm. If I work the places that I like to work. Mm-hmm. I ain't, you know, financially fat, but I ain't skinny no more either, right. You know. But so that. Part of the joy is you sit back and enjoy your friends, your family, you know, and I've got good kids, and they've grown up, and they're nice.
How many kids do you have?
I have 3 and 1 on the way, maybe. No, I don't want to mislead anyone. I'm 63. I ain't going to mislead you, you know. my wife and I, Altavis and I, are adopting a boy.
Mm-hmm.
And he is... We're still waiting for official okays and all of that, but that is a joy for me, and to be around people that I enjoy being around. And I say this to you on a one-to-one basis. You ever need me, you got me for the rest of my life. As a friend, you've got me. If you need me to come on here and do something, that's the reason why I wanted to do the song, because I didn't want somebody to say, well, when you're on Johnny Carson, he sing. How come he didn't sing on Al Shields? Got no time for that. I'll make a deal with you right now that when I come back, when we get through, I've got to go to, because you're going to be around for an awful long time. Liza and I are doing the Red Cross Gala in Monte Carlo in August. When I get back, when you start your fall season, let me bring my guys and augment them with your group, and let me come down and do some stuff for you one night.
Oh, that would be great. Huh? That would be great.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Sammy Davis Jr. Thank you.
Next guest is a very talented comedian. Exactly. Somebody just had comedy orgasm up in the top row. Before she comes out, ah! She's a very talented comedian who is a regular on a show called Open House, which is an all-new version of the show you know as Duet. It starts this fall. Please welcome Ellen DeGeneres.
It's nice to be here. How are you? Great. Great. Me too. I am a comedian. It's a good job. I like it. People always come up to me after the show and talk to me, you know, and they always ask me questions. They always say, you know, first of all, Ellen, you're incredible, you know. But second of all, is your life as a performer that much different than ours, the little people, the nobodies, the scum? And I'll tell you, I don't think so. I think that we all do the same things, basically. I think that we all... Like, we all try to get out of a ticket. If we get pulled over by a policeman, nobody's going to just admit, oh, yeah, I was going about 95, give me that ticket. I mean, you're going to try to get out of that ticket somehow. You're just hoping you can come up with some story. If you're a woman, you're attractive, you're dressed nicely, you're going to try to flirt your way out of that ticket. But if you've just thrown some horrible outfit on just to run to the store to pick up some Haagen-Dazs, thinking you're not going to see anybody, that's when you get picked up. You know, you're just sitting there just hoping to come up with anything. You just... Hi. Hi. Listen, before you start writing. You know what happened? I was just at home, just a minute ago, just right at home, and phone rang. Hello, picked it up, and it was my mother. She said, Ellen, honey? And that's my name, hi. That's not the honey part, that's a term of endearment, but you could call me honey, doesn't matter. But. She said, Ellen, honey, I've fallen down, and I think I've broken my neck. Oh, I know. So right away, went to the store to get that Haagen-Dazs, and she loves it so. And just threw this on. This is horrible, this thing. I was naked. And just naked at home alone doing some aerobicizing. And... I'm single, you know, so I do that. But I think it's important to keep in shape, you know, being single like I am, you know, because I date a lot of guys. Not a lot, that's trampy. But I just, you know, I'm not even seeing anybody seriously right now. It's just, you know, it's so hard to meet anybody. I'm so shy. It's hard to talk to. Not hard to talk to you. Something about you I like. But it is really hot today. Isn't the heat something? I don't mind the heat. Heat is, there's nothing wrong with heat. I guess people just don't like to sweat. And you must be hot with all that on. Look at the handcuffs and everything. But there's nothing wrong with sweating, really. You know, sweating is just a natural bodily function, a thing on your lip. I wouldn't worry about that. You know, just think everybody sweats. It's pigs don't sweat. They don't have sweat glands. That's why they roll around the mud like that. People think it's because they're dirty animals, but it's actually... Policemen are called pigs, aren't they? The same, I think, basically. I found out pigs do not have sweat glands. How many people knew that? They do not have. I learned that playing Trivial Pursuit, which is a game that I despise. I don't know if you hate it as much as I do, but I think stupid people hate it the most because you're just sitting there, just waiting for it to be your turn so you can say, I don't know. I don't know. Danny Kaye, what? 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 Just guessing anything. I get the question, what is the only animal that mates while going 60 miles an hour? Do you know what it is? No. Thanks for playing. It is the, and Danny Kaye was a bad guess, I realize that now, but it's the golden eagle. This is what they do, actually. The truth, they actually, the male and the female both go 3 to 4 miles high, they start going 60 miles an hour, then they connect in some bird type of a way, and then they just start dropping, and they don't stop dropping until the act is completed, so it's not uncommon that they both fall all the way to the ground, hit the ground, both of them die. That's how committed they are to this. I thought to myself, boy, don't we feel like wimps for stopping to answer the phone. Hello, wait a minute, Jesus, hello. Nothing, what are you doing? I mean, I don't know about, that is commitment, you know? I don't know about you, but if I'm one of these two birds, you're getting close to the ground, I would seriously consider faking it. Okay. Woo! Thank you very much.
I guess with the television, relatives that you've never heard of are popping out of the woodwork.
It's weird, yeah, that happens. You know, people come up to me and I really, first of all, I have the worst memory anyway, you know, so no matter who comes up to me, you know, they're just like, I can't believe you don't remember me. I'm sorry. Oh, Dad. You know, and then finally, I really don't. I mean, people come up to me and we were best friends. You don't remember? And they tell me these wild things that we did. And I don't even remember having a goat, first of all. And stories that, you're going, I would remember that, I think. I can't believe, but really, that happens all the time. And I feel like, so now I just go, oh, sure, I remember you. And I don't remember them. But if it's someone that's watching, I remember you, of course. But
other than obviously the night with the goat,
two nights.
Yeah. They remember two nights. Yeah. What did you do before you got into this business professionally? How did you make money?
Well, besides the goat, I am really making it. I did everything. I mean, I really had no idea what I wanted to do. I think my parents were very worried about me because I was 23 years old and I had no idea. I worked in a glove factory for about a day and a half. Mm-hmm. And my mother worked there. And I remember like midday, the second day, I said, you know, I'm not feeling well. I'm going to go home. And she said, you're not coming back, are you? I said, no. And so I never came back. And I worked jobs like that, like for a day or two. I was a waitress. I sold clothes. I was a vacuum cleaner salesman, and
where?
At Hoover, and I'd go to different for Hoover, the vacuum cleaner, and I'd go to different stores and demonstrate when people were shopping. I'd throw mud in front of them and pass, and that's what I did. And boy, did that job suck. You know that. That was one of my first jokes when I started doing comedy. I would do, because I had just done that, and I would use humor to sell. That's what I was so good with just coming up with something people would buy, like. The most expensive vacuum cleaner had a light on the front of it. And I was trying to make that sale, and the woman said, why do I need a light on the front of a vacuum cleaner? And I said, that's so that you can vacuum at night and not wake up people by turning the lights on. And so... she bought it.
She did?
Yeah, she bought it. I mean, I did a lot of things. I didn't know what I was going to do.
Have you always wanted to do comedy?
No, I really didn't. Until I got on stage, until I was talked into it, because I didn't want to, you know, do it until... some friends said, you know, we're having a benefit, we need to raise some money, and I don't even know what the benefit was for. It was like, I think somebody needed a new pair of jeans or something at the time. And I went on stage, and I don't even know what I did, but it was funny at the time. Now, if we look back on it, it would be very unfunny, I think, but I loved it. It was just the greatest feeling, and it just fell in my lap. Everything just kept happening, and So.
Well, good luck with the show coming up.
Thanks.
And the new name change. Ellen DeGeneres. We'll be back.
Consideration provided by 1-800-COLLECT, America's inexpensive way to call someone collect. Use it every time you make a long distance collect call.
I'd like to thank my guests Ellen DeGeneres and Sammy Davis Jr. And I'll see you tomorrow night when I'll have more guests.
Talk shows.
Excuse me, George Herbert.
Nice monologue.
Do nothing, deficit raising.
Throwing shade.
Quail loving, sushi puking.
Weird talk shows. Weird talk shows.
I ate his liver with some fava beans and a nice Chianti.
Weird talk shows.
And the dog was...
Weird talk shows.
Oh, man, I knew I shouldn't have had you on the show.
People who don't know this yet, but we've switched their seats with new Folgers crystals. Don't tell them.
Hi, how are you? Good to see you. What's up? Yeah. Boy, welcome to the Arsenio Hall Show. I am he, and have you ever, thank you very much, thank you, man. Have you ever wanted something or bought something, and then when you get it, you realize you do not need it? Like a month later or something? Okay, I had a phone put in my bathroom. Next to the toilet. Anybody got a phone next to the toilet? Yeah.
We don't need a damn phone next to the toilet. If you make a call, what you gonna say? You know, hey, Sharon, how you doing, baby? Yeah. Oh, what am I doing? nothing. I was just sitting here on the toilet, and for some reason, I thought of your ass. I don't know. You don't even want nobody to know where you are when you're talking on the phone. You be trying to do it quietly and everything, you know? It's like, oh, you know what else is weird? You ever travel and notice that hotels always put a bottle opener next to the toilet? Does anybody ever stay in the bathroom so damn long you get thirsty and, well, you take an igloo full of Pepsi and something? It's like, oh, I've been in here 2-3 days now, you know? So silly, but that's real life. What's going on in politics? Last week, you know, that Bush was in South Carolina, and he ate at a restaurant called the Waffle House for a purpose. He wanted to emphasize his reoccurring theme that Bill Clinton waffles on issues. And not to be outdone, tonight, Bill Clinton will be dining at a restaurant called the International Lies and Iran-Contra House.
Five times I've seen
ya! Even Waffle House. Yeah. Yes. Hey, Gordy, what would James Brown think of that little bit of satire? Yes, yes. oh, gosh. This is a weird story. According to the FBI, drug smugglers tried to bring cocaine into this country. You saw this on the news. By melting the cocaine down, right? And they make like a mix of cocaine and fiberglass. And then they build little dog cages and pet cages that you travel with. But actually, the cage is cocaine. How do you come up with these kind of ideas? You got to be snorting coke to come up with an idea like that. You got to be like, okay. I got a great way, man. We can move stuff across the border, okay? With absolutely no risk to us, man. No risk to us, okay? See, what we do is, okay, we melt the cocaine down and put it with fiberglass, and we make cages that you put dogs into. Yeah, I'm gonna go burn my woman with my crack pipe. I'll be right back. What the hell? I mean, you have to be high to come up with stuff like that. But they should put that genius into something positive, you know? I mean, because that is genius. This is genius, too. You probably saw this on the news. It was the other smuggling story that I found interesting. Colombian police were looking out for drug smugglers, and they did a strip search on a lady who had like a funny shaped butt, right? And they found 2 8-inch incisions in her rear and continued to look and found that she had 8 bags of heroin surgically implanted in her butt. Now that's genius. Yes. 8 pounds of heroin implanted in her booty. I lie not. And you thought Cindy Crawford had a valuable booty. This lady had heroin in hers. Sounds like the inspiration for like a new Sir Mix-a-Lot song. Baby's got smack. Who knows? Boy. Yes. You all look like you're ready. Are you ready? I got Sandra Bernhard in the house for you. And Public Enemy. Let's go. Yes. Oh, yeah. My first guest is an actress, comedian, and she had a Playboy layout I want to ask her about. I haven't seen her since I saw that. please welcome Sandra Bernhard.
Hey, baby.
You're trying to look hard, but you know you ain't hard.
No, I feel very vulnerable and very scared tonight.
These are
kind of fat.
Well, yeah. I had to wear them so I could kick Barbara Bush's ass.
Oh.
Let's talk politics.
I don't know if you saw her on Larry King, but she blew me away.
No, I didn't see her.
I'd never really seen her speak before, you know? She's just been kind of hiding behind, you know, the whole image of being like a nice lady.
Mm-hmm.
And then she comes out and she's just doing total rhetoric right out of George's mouth.
Mm.
And then they're talking about how she'd gone to the Republican convention and somebody ripped off her red ribbon, you know, which represents, you know, AIDS awareness, as you know. And she's, well, sometimes she wears it, sometimes she doesn't. She gave a big attitude about it. I said, the woman should be sleeping with that red ribbon on, you know, first of all. And it's like, you know, her whole trip about AIDS babies. Yeah, it's real cute to hold an AIDS baby. When has she showed up to an AIDS hospice? When have they made any kind of, like, public announcement of their support, you know, to AIDS research and who it's really affected?
Yeah. What did you think about Magic quitting the board?
I thought it was right on. And, you know, did George Bush even really acknowledge it with any kind of respect? I mean, a man like Magic Johnson isn't just going to drop out of it if there isn't a damn good reason,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Yeah.
And he just, like, he just goes on these campaign tours and talks about what a great country this is. You know, God bless America. Did he show up during the riots here in L.A.? Did he give a damn about the inner city?
Yeah.
You know? I mean, it's like, to me, it's like the Twilight Zone. It's like there are people, there are homeless people, there are people dying of AIDS, there are people having their rights taken away, and this man is like convincing like the white middle class that everything is all right. I mean, are they living in a dream world or what?
Yeah. Well.
And you would just, I mean, you would just hope that a woman would have more compassion. You would hope that the wife would cut through all the bull and just say, hey, we really have to, you know, get real, George.
Yeah.
It's really blowing my mind, you know?
Hasn't Barbara been able to soften him up on the abortion issue a little?
I don't think so. She doesn't really say anything about it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's like, it's so weird. I was watching the marathon on A&E, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Mary Tyler Moore had all the reruns, you know, and it was, they remind me, I was in high school, you know, it was like 1972, and here was this, like, really independent, great lady in a slim slack with a flare, living in her own apartment with Parsons tables, you know, handling every situation, a great job, and believe me, you can bet if Mary needed an abortion, she wouldn't have thought twice about it in 1972, and Lou would have been there to hold her hand. And here we are 20 years later, and it's like, I mean, we're like, it's like prehistoric. How can they even, like, suggest that we have to go back to you know, to those really ridiculous, contrived times when women had no, you know, rights for, you know, to make their own decision? I mean, it's insane.
Yeah.
I'm furious.
Yeah. What do you think of Perot?
Well, I think he's a little crazy.
Yeah, he is different.
You know? I mean, I don't know. I think he kind of jumped in at the wrong time.
Like,
maybe if he'd stayed in at the beginning, I don't know.
Yeah.
But
this whole thing with his daughter in it sounds a little, yeah.
I got kind of caught up during the debates with him a little bit because he was kind of exciting and, you know, he kind of threw a curveball into it. But then the other day he seemed like to kind of lose it a little bit, so I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know what's going on with him.
You're definitely going to vote, though, right?
Yeah, I'm going to vote, and I'm going to vote for Clinton, because we need a social change.
Yeah.
I hope that, you know, he can pull it off. I hope that, you know, he can really come through with some of the things he's talking about, but I think just on the absolute basis of, like, people needing to feel that there is some alternative to this kind of right-wing, fundamentalist, reactionary, you know, society we're living in, I think we need to vote for him.
Do you think the polls, they seem to be narrowing, and the guys are getting very close?
That's why I wanted to say this. I mean, you know, normally I don't get political, you know.
And what do you think the reason for that is? Is it the character issue that's been brought up about Clinton?
Well, I mean, we've spent 4 years looking at a man completely lie to us, right to our face, like I meant, you know, like I just said, about all these really, really essential issues.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, the financial thing, I mean, you know, I'm willing to, I'm in the upper, so are you, I'm in the upper bracket.
Yeah.
I'm willing to pay more taxes to bring better education, better health, and better social. I'm willing to do it.
Yeah.
And so should everybody who's in that category. So how much money do you need? How many fabulous things do you need in your life? I mean, you have to be willing to give to people, you know, the people who are less fortunate.
Yeah, when Bill Clinton was here, he told me, he says, you know, I'm going to kill you when I get in, you know, I mean, because the 200,000...
They're already killing us anyways,
yeah, but,
you know?
But he'll be killing us softly, and I think that's a better alternative, that we help the masses. And
I think it's our responsibility. Not everybody gets to be where we are. And I think we really have to give that back.
Yeah. Yeah.
We'll be right back with more Sandra Bernhard.
Funky, mother.
It was very, very funny to watch the news this morning, and there was a story called Hollywood Under Attack. And Hollywood is being attacked, especially film, for moral choices.
Right.
Then I read notes about Roseanne and find out that you are going to leave Tom Arnold for Morgan Fairchild. They are going to flip out now.
Well, Tom Arnold left me last year.
Oh, my.
And, yeah, I'm coming out. Yeah, and it's funny, I ran into Morgan Fairchild at the movies out in the valley, and she came over and said hi to me, and a few days later they had a casting for the part of my lover on the show, and she called and she wanted to play my lover. I was like all tripped out. So we taped the show a couple weeks ago, and we have curtain call afterwards, so we all run down, and I went to kiss her, like to trip her out, and she turned her cheek like that. She got all freaked out. She couldn't quite go the distance with
me. So it wasn't...
No, she's cool, though. She's funny. It's very good.
And
it's
have you cool. been getting responses on this desire to act that out? I mean, because I don't think they'd be trying to stop it from happening, you know?
Oh, they can't stop. They can't stop Roseanne. You know that.
Yeah.
Roseanne has the power.
And ABC, what have they said?
I think they're totally into it. I mean, so the ratings are going to go through the roof.
So this is progress.
Please. I mean, it's like these fundamentalists, the Babe Buchanans, the Pat Buchanans, I mean, they're all like, you know, abused children anyways. That's why they're so screwed up, you know. And my heart goes out to them. It really does, you know. I think they're probably a family from incest or some kind of weird trip. And that's why they're so freaked out about the thing. But, I mean, they're living in a dream world if they don't think, you know, probably, you know, 70 to 80% of the population hasn't had at least one homosexual experience or hasn't fantasized about it on a regular basis. I mean, get real, you know. Everybody's a little bi.
I've been fantasizing about you and Morgan Fairchild ever since I read the notes. You know?
No, I mean, we're going to... I tell you, if we have another 4 years of Bush, this country is going to explode, baby. It's going to be one funky, funky scene. So they better get Clinton in there because, you know, people have got to start dealing with reality.
It's very scary.
I mean, I don't know where this all, like, got twisted and crazy, but it's just like, that's just the way it is. There's gays, there's homeless, there's, you know... There's racism, there's sexism, there's all this stuff that exists.
Yeah. Can we talk about the Playboy layout? Because I haven't seen you since it came out. It was very interesting. I even pulled one picture that I can show them. Yeah. Sandy?
Really? Oh, okay.
Yeah. And you know...
Swinging again.
My favorite was the picture in the gold.
Yeah.
How did you do that?
They sponged it on. Mm-hmm. Karen Kawahara, my makeup artist, is brilliant. She sponged it all over. Just, it's like, it's breathable. It's not like, you know, Goldfinger where they sprayed paint you and then you had to, like, leave a little spot in your back so you didn't suffocate. they have modern technology now. And it took about 2 days to get it all off. In some spots. Like, behind my ears.
Yeah. But what do you think of Madonna's book, Sex?
Oh, she has a new book out? I didn't know anything about it. It must be very controversial and very edgy and very revolutionary, I'm sure.
Yeah, it's you got some pictures left from that monologue.
Oh, that's okay.
Yeah, oh, no, there's one.
Yep. Oh, wow.
That's the only one I can show you.
Oh, really? That's good. I've seen enough.
Okay, back to politics.
Let's get into safer territory. Let's talk about the fundamentalists.
Yeah, how about Sinead?
I thought that was one of the coolest things she's ever done. Because in Northern Ireland, you know, there's a big problem. Mm-hmm. They've taken away, you know, all of women's rights, and, you know, the church kind of controls the state there. So I think she had legitimate, you know, honest, first-hand experience, you know, with the church and those and that reaction to it. Mm-hmm. I thought it was very bold, you know.
So you think if people here knew more about her country,
yeah,
they wouldn't be so angry at her?
I think so. You know, it's the first time I've actually kind of respected her in a way. She's always kind of bugged me with her bald head and her insane kind of gesticulation. I mean, I don't love her as a performer, and I think sometimes she gets a little out of hand, but I mean, I can't, you know, fight her for her, you know, for her experience.
Yeah. You always talk about old artists and the performers you love. What current do you like? What out there now do you listen to?
Music?
Mm-hmm.
I haven't bought an album for a while. To tell you, I've been traveling so much. I'm just trying to think of something off the top of my head that I really like.
Because you like Diana Ross and...
Yeah, well, I mean, I like, you know, from the, really, the 30s and 40s on up.
Peggy Lee,
yeah. Peggy's cool.
Yeah.
You know?
And you don't listen to stuff now? I would think you'd be right on the cutting edge.
Well, I am, but I'm just like, I'm too tired to even turn the radio on, you know? I just want it quiet in my house.
You gotta slow down.
I'm a little burnt out. Yeah. Let's go back from Paris again.
What's the latest fashion rage in Paris?
There really wasn't one. It was kind of, I was in the Chanel show, mm-hmm. and it was all kind of diaphanous and, you know, safe and sexy and cute. But I mean, there wasn't like no major trend that I could pick up on.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's kind of the 70s, kind of the 60s, kind of the 80s. I don't know what the hell's going on. It's a melange.
we got some dates we got to talk about here somewhere. Let's see. Oh, UCLA.
Right.
October 29th, you'll
tomorrow
be doing
night.
Your one-woman show?
No.
Uh-oh.
No, I'm not.
USC, UCLA.
Oh, come on, shut up. who cares? They're putting money in my pocket. Be quiet. Well, bring me out to USC.
Yeah, you'll go to USC.
Match it and raise it, and I'll come out there. I'm doing a consciousness raising and rap session there tomorrow night, but I'm doing my one-woman show at the Paramount Theater in New York, November 21st.
Yeah.
So that's,
and it's called
Giving Till It Hurts. Yeah, it's a show I've been touring with off and on all year.
Yeah. You did a song for us here once.
Yeah, I did. Well, you want me to do another one with Public Enemy?
That would be a duo.
Are they ready for a Jewish girl in 92?
I don't know. I'll ask them when they come out.
Okay, well, that's why I came on the show, because, you know, I mean, Bush may be back, but I'm still trying my best, you know, to get us together. And get out and vote, and let's change, because next time I come back here, I want some real family values, like the real American family. Like, it includes all of us, okay?
Yeah, like my
How
single
it?
Mom who raised
yeah.
me.
Yeah. Thank you.
We'll be right back. This is Sandra Bernhard.
Love you.
One critic called my next guest not only a great rap group, but one of the best rock bands on the planet. Their music is anything but safe, and that's why they're one of the most controversial... Yeah, anything but safe. One of the most controversial acts in the business. Please welcome Chuck D and Flavor Flav, Public Enemy. So, Chuck, you don't dance.
I dance, man. You know, I fool some people, you know what I'm saying? You know, we all black, right?
Yeah.
So that's what it's about, right?
Absolutely, man. You know, I was surprised that you all have discovered so many or, and sprung so many careers that I don't think the general public knows about.
Well, you know, we have a history of being rap advocates. You know, I spent a lot of time doing this, studying it for 16 years. The beginning guys of rap, the Grandmaster Flashes, the Africa Bambaataz, on up to Run DMCs, the LLs, I've been big fans. So, you know, our whole thing is to make our music grow and to show that we as black people can have something and not lose it like we lost the blues or jazz. You know, rap is the black American folk story. It's the black American folk tale, male and female. And it's something that we definitely need to be around to control. And right now, I see that we're losing control of it.
Yeah, and some of those groups that you've helped out, Hammer is one of them, actually.
Well, you know, when we was going out on tour, we've been on 22 tours, and back in the days of 88, we was one of the guys from the East Coast that happened to put rap groups from the other parts of the country and say rap is a universal thing. Not only rap is from all over parts of the country, but it's all over the world. So it would surprise some people where they could find rap. Rap is in the Fiji Islands, New Zealand, Brazil, and we've been to all of those places. And back in the days, you know, we've given a helping hand to such as, you know, guys like Hammer, vice versa too. Mm-hmm. Mix-a-Lot, you know, Ice Cube, N.W.A., Too Short, you know, as well as the brothers like EPMD, Stetsasonic from the East Coast. So, you know, it's one big family thing, and that's one thing we try to maintain.
Yeah, a few days ago, I think that one of the big things in the news was the concert in Arizona. Now, I heard on one broadcast you did one song, another broadcast said two songs, but however many, you left early.
Yeah, well, number one, you know, it was against our principles to even be in Arizona, but at the same time, we had to go there and push the point that it was only 10 days away from the election day, where they could actually vote in the Martin Luther King holiday into existence over there. So we went over there and we played our intro. You know, we didn't just want to come out like, boom, here we go. Mm-hmm. No, we have our intro, which is a song called Lost at Birth on our album. And then we played By the Time I Get to Arizona. So by the time we got to Arizona, we let people know, it was 80,000 people, say, yo, man, look, if we ever going to come back here, man, before things going to be all right, you know, vote that day in, you know, and, you know, make sure that things are right. You know, because right now I looked at it as being a slap in the face. You got one state that says, you know, forget Martin Luther King. I don't care how y'all feel. And to me, you know, black people, we're wise, intelligent people. And we should be given credit where credit's due.
Yeah. The video, by the time I get to Arizona, was very controversial because of the violence. And MTV wouldn't play it?
Well, MTV ran a poll on it, and they ran a poll, and the people that called MTV said they favor it, you know, 66% to 33%, and they still didn't play it. That's all right. I'm not asking for people to play the video. We're just asking for it to be shown once, to give our point of view, tell people about our principles, and, you know, it was kind of violent, but basically, if it didn't show the violence in it, it wouldn't have gotten any kind of noise out of it. They would have just looked over and it wouldn't have been no big issue. And basically the violence was a slap in the face of the American system that has been violent to us for what, 400, 500 years? Mm-hmm. So,
yeah.
I mean, I just had to show, like, see how you would feel about politicians. This is how we feel about, you know, how we've been getting it.
Okay.
You know, you gotta be hard, you gotta be strong. And a lot of times, you know, when they show the black male image in a lot of the media circles, you know, we gotta take the bass out of our voice, or we just gotta lessen up. Nah, we've always been like that. And a lot of times that we've shown so much consistency, a lot of people tend to take it's like, okay, that's PE at it again. So you gotta keep on coming out even stronger and stronger, but I mean, how strong can you get? You just gotta be consistent. And our people need to get used to consistency.
Yeah, now everybody, everybody called Martin Luther King the Prince of Peace. If he saw that video, what do you think he would feel?
He'd have been upset at seeing himself get shot, first of all. Mm-hmm. And I think...
Yo, kick it, y'all, kick it, man, kick it, G.
I'm saying straight up, if Dr. King would have dodged the bullets, and he would have had a different point of view exactly on... you know, how to look at things, you know what I'm saying? But it's in all respect to Dr. King, we want to see it. Dr. King was one of my heroes. We might not share all of our philosophies as people, because we're all people and everybody thinks differently. Mm-hmm. But he's one of my heroes, too. You can't say he ain't.
Right.
But this is what I think. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You know, I got, you know, like, different type of heroes also, like Nat Turner, Malcolm, you know,
yeah.
Harriet Tubman, Sister Soldier, Ice-T, Ice Cube, you know, we go on and on, you know, yeah. Jim Brown.
Yeah. Yeah, we take a quick commercial and come right back with more of these two gentlemen.
I like that. My man does the poetry up there.
Yeah.
Brother Williams.
Yeah, John right. Williams. What's the origin of the clock?
Flay.
Oh, what's up, G? Oh, yo, I was just grooving, man. Yo, they funky, man. They
yeah.
funky.
Yeah.
When did the clock start, man? What's the origin of that? Well, the clock started, man. Oh, man, I can't say because nobody was around when the clock started.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? You know, but I mean, you know, the significance behind this clock here, you know, a lot of people think that I wear the clock just to be flashy or to be funny, but this just is an indication that time as being a very important element that can't afford to be wasted, you know, and, you know, each, you know, moment that we live our lives, we gotta use each minute to our best value, mm-hmm. you know? Yeah. You know, time brought us in. Time brought us in, and time takes us out. You know what I'm saying? And not only that, but I always say, yo, I'm clocking. That means I'm paying attention. So you can't get fast on me, because I know what time it is.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you have a business in New York, I read about it in New York Magazine.
Yeah, well, you know, my brother Steve, you know, had me open up a barbershop. He talked me into opening up a barbershop because my brother's a barber and everything, you know? So, you know, I decided to open up this barbershop. And right now it's doing pretty well. You know, I got four nice fly barbers in there doing, you know, hair, you know, cutting hair. And I got a girl in there that do the nails and stuff. And also this guy in there, his name is Victor. He made the shirt here for me, you know. Try to get everybody to see this, you know.
Haircuts,
but this, yeah,
nails,
yeah, we also do airbrushing inside my shop, you know.
Yeah.
Y'all know it's funky. All of that, you know.
You have some very strong opinions on black businesses. I heard this morning that Bill Cosby is interested in buying NBC.
Bill kind of large, then.
Yeah,
right?
Bill been large all my life.
No, I think that's a smart move. You know, one thing I would say, you know, and I'm not endorsing anybody. But first of all, people got to be wise to know that the person that's been involved with the current administration for the last 12 years, common sense will tell you, you can't swing that way if you're talking about problems now.
Mm-hmm.
All right? And that's talking about Bush. If he's been in there the last 12 years, he was the vice president, right?
Yeah.
And if people think he just started 4 years ago, no, this is like 12 years of the same old. So you want to give somebody a new shot. Now, one thing Perot been talking about is like he's been talking about businesses, you know, ain't nothing going to get better in the inner city. What they mean by inner city is black, you know? Yeah. Ain't nothing gonna get better for the black cause unless we have our own businesses. Now we talk about needing jobs, but if we don't have our own businesses, we can't provide jobs in our communities, mm-hmm. you know? And when Los Angeles went up, that was the whole thing. It's like, if I ain't got control over my community, it ain't my community. Mm-hmm. We gotta control a lot of commerce. And you know, these things have to be taught to us in the school systems. In the school systems, they don't teach you how to build a business. They might teach you how to run one, but to build one is providing a service to your community. Mm-hmm. And that's what we have to kind of train ourselves or get trained to run in our community, to really have it to be our community. So that's very important for us. That's how our dollars go around our community. It's something that got to be taught, and it's something that has really been played low-key ever since our existence in this country. We can't really think of ourselves as being Americans until we become part of, you know, come to the table on our own. And, you know, that's one thing that Minister Farrakhan and the Nation of Islam and Elijah Muhammad's principles have always been about, self-sufficiency. We can hold our own. The black woman has been holding up our community for so long, it's time for the black man to come on the side. So let's do this. Mm-hmm. Then our children can say, yo, I got a job. Right now, we knocking on the doors and everybody else talk about, yo, what's up with the job? You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You ain't gonna get no job, you got no business. And that's common sense. And Ross Perot talked about that. He said, yo, you know, it ain't gonna get better for the black situation unless you're able to provide services for your own.
Will you be voting in this election?
Locally. Yeah. You know, right now we're going through some stuff in our hometown of Roosevelt, Strong Island. And
Freeport, Long Island in the house, too.
And, you know, a lot of people came down because I was saying, you know, what we need to do is vote out them old politicians that have been, like, taking the money. And a lot of people came down on me because I said, what we need in our hometown, which is 1 square mile, is a, you know, a fat youth center. Because mm-hmm. I'm part of the youth that came out, you know, 16, 17. Where is it a place to go? Nowhere. Out on the curb, out on the corner, you know. And these things and programs need to be in more black communities and run by more black men. And if, you know, rehabilitation was really in the jail system, then, you know, that would be some kind of program where we could really build our communities. Yeah. But there's that conspiracy, C-O-N-spiracy, that mm-hmm. really, you know, has brothers go to the joint, come out, and more lost than they've been found. So mm-hmm. right now, you know, right now a change in America got to happen at the top, but for us in our community, it also got to start from the bottom, straight up.
So will you vote in the presidential election also, maybe?
Yeah, but I can't tell y'all.
I'm running for president. Y'all, can man. I get some votes? Yeah, G's playing for president.
I'm just saying, right now, people got to look in the leadership, in the black community leadership in themselves. Look mm-hmm. in the mirror. You looking for a leader? Be one. Yeah. Stop looking for everybody else. Mm-hmm. And right now, we gotta worry about so much grassroots politics and dealing with each other. You know, maybe even dealing on a presidential level might be over our heads. White America right now is looking at all kinds of problems. So you know if they looking at problems, you know we gonna get it. So right now, we gotta be wise and say, all right, let's deal with being a leader ourselves and make the logical decision who not to vote for.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You talked about Mike Tyson in one interview. Would you speak on it for a minute?
Well, basically, it wasn't talking about the particular case, per se, whether he did or he didn't. I'm not even getting into that. It's talking about how the Indiana jury was like, well, let's get this nigga. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Well, regardless of the circumstance, you know, we got a prime opportunity. He's between a rock and a hard place. We're going to get him no matter what. Forget the case. And the whole thing of getting Mike Tyson happened to be bigger than the actual case between him and the sister, whatever happened. Yeah. And I'm not even talking about, I'm not even dealing with those right terms of that text. But on my cover of my 12-inch, which has been banned by a lot of record stores.
Yeah, but I got it here. this is an interesting picture, and this was in Indiana, I guess, in what year?
1930, Marion, Indiana. And it got a picture of two brothers, I don't know if y'all got it, two brothers hanging from the rope. And the jury is right down here. And I likened it and made a comparison to the Mike Tyson case. And a lot of people are mad at that. But like I said, you know, like, so many brothers and sisters is hanging by the rope of a justice system that's been corrupt from its root that, you know, like, people ain't even second-guessing it. And right now, in order for America to get better, people got to just sit and think a little bit. You know, like we say, common sense will fix things. But sense has never really been common. I'm on that note.
Public Enemy will be right back to perform for you. Flavor Flav, Chuck D.
Performing Hazy Shade of Criminal from their latest CD, Greatest Misses. This is Public Enemy.
Yeah! FBI agents coming after us with a license to kill 30 mil, claiming it's just a drug bust. Come on! Pump it up, y'all!
Play the fool out of real beef, cools in a pool.
down the bottle, boy. Freeport, Long Island in the house. Roosevelt.
Public Enemy video, The Enemy Strikes Live, is available in stores right this minute. And John B. Williams will be at the Hollywood Roosevelt Hotel, the Center Grill, through October 31st. Take me home, y'all. This is a very funny man from the East Coast. He hosts the half-hour comedy hour on MTV, and he'll be appearing in Chicago at the Funny Firm from December 17th through the 22nd. Please give it up for Mario Joyner.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you very much. Well, folks, I hope you're doing your Christmas shopping. You got to get out there and do it early. You get the best deals that way. I ran into a nice bargain the other day. I was shopping for some sweaters. I saw a sign that said, management not responsible for lost or stolen items. I put the sweater on and walked out. See, I'm responsible for everything I steal. That's just the type of thief I am. You know, like I'm going to bring it back, you know. And I don't know, Christmas isn't as fun as it was, you know, when I was a child. Now that I'm an adult, you know, it's no good. When I was a kid, that was Christmas. You know, you come downstairs, all those presents under the tree, you didn't pay for nothing. That was a great thing. I don't know why they took that away. They should bring that back. That was the best part of Christmas. Coming downstairs, all this stuff for you, not a nickel out of your pocket. And my mother would get me anything, too. I'd break all my toys. I never had one toy that lived to see the New Year, ever. You know? By the time New Year's came, my toys were broken. That was my job as a kid, I thought. Get my toys, break them as soon as I get them. My older brother, he could break anything. I got a brother that broke a magnet one year. A magnet. My mother bought him a magnet. He played with it for like an hour. Next thing I know, it wouldn't stick to nothing. That's all I remember. He had it so messed up, it could repel metal. That's how bad he was. Put it on the refrigerator, it'd fall down, shoot across the room. One year we had a G.I. Joe. Me and my brother had to share one doll. One G.I. Joe for two kids. I don't know what my mother was thinking about, but it sure wasn't the welfare of the doll, that's for sure. You know, you give one kid one G.I. Joe, he gets beat up bad enough. You put two kids on a G.I. Joe. I don't care what kind of soldier you claim to be, you going down this Christmas. It was right out the box, straight into combat. I start sticking needles in his eyes and stuff. Little boys are crazy when they get dolls, man. I used to run him over with my bike and stuff, you know. I beat him so bad, couldn't find him for 3 days. He ran away. I think my mother found him in the basement, crying with a grenade in his hand. Back, everybody, get back. I'm trying to talk him down. Just calm down, Joe. We're just playing with you. Oh, you call that plan sticking my head in the fan? Move away from the door. He took his receipt and returned himself. It was a terrible Christmas. My dad, I gotta get my dad a watch. I wanted to get him a watch. I was gonna buy him a Rolex until I found out how much they cost. You know, over $1,000 for this watch. Nothing special about it either. I asked the saleswoman, what's so special about it? She says, nothing. I go, is it waterproof? She goes, no, but it's water resistant. Well, what the hell is that? Waterproof means water won't harm the watch. What is water resistant? Well, water will harm it, but it puts up a damn good fight, you know. It'll be 2-3 days before it succumbs to the moisture. It's a good watch. Just wanted to throw that in there. I know the joke was over, but I figured, you know, what the hell. I have relatives in the South. I have to go down south for some of the holiday season. And I hate that because it snows in the South, and people in the South just panic when it snows. They cannot handle snow in the South. You know, a little bit of snow falls, they freak out. Up here, and like, where I live in Pittsburgh. I'm from Pittsburgh. I live in New York. We shovel the snow. It's no big deal. You know, you come outside, shovel it. No problem. In the South, they can't even use shovels. They have them. They start walking outside, swinging at the snowflakes. They're coming too fast. It's like the white demon from heaven coming down to kill them. Snowblowers pointing them in the air. Come on, Earl, get it before this to ground, man. You ever see them walk in the snow? They don't walk in the snow in the South. I was walking, they looked at me like I was Moses when he parted the Red Sea. That's a miracle, man. I ain't gonna do that. You might slip and break a butt bone. But I gotta go down there, you know. Family down there. And I hate driving through the South, too. Weird names for towns. I was driving through a town called Lynchburg. I went through that town about 90 miles an hour. Thanks, you've been great. Thanks a lot.
Mario Joyner.
Yes. I don't know what you want to talk about.
Pretty legs. No, I'm kidding. I got a new movie coming out also. It's called For the Boys in the Hood. Y'all should go see that. Real nice. Check that out. You know, a lot of nice little funny songs. Real nice. That's coming out.
Did you buy your mom a house or something like
that? Yeah, I did. So I feel fulfilled as a son now. Yeah. I'm buying her house. I'm in the process of doing that right now. You know, and she's happy, you know. Yeah. I would buy my dad a house too, but my dad doesn't like new things. So, you know. He's gonna live in that same old shack that he's living in, you know, because he just won't leave. You know, fathers, that's their house, you know. He won't leave the house. He'll go see my mom's house and come, you know, back to his little place. He likes nothing new. I can't get him to use a microwave, nothing.
You know, really?
Won't buy an answering machine, nothing. Thinks microwaves are evil, you know. He thinks he can tell the difference between food cooked in the microwave and food cooked on a stove, you know. He'd be smelling the food. You cooked this in the microwave? I don't want this, no.
We'll be back later.